Jesus answered and said to her, Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen the good part, which will not be taken from her. It means to rest means that I must also learn to rest spiritually. I need to learn to rest spiritually. So, how do I do that? I'm going to read to you Hebrews, the 4th chapter. As far as I'm concerned, it gives to you a lot of counsel about learning to rest in Christ. Therefore, since a promise remains to enter what? His rest. Let us fear lest any of you seem to have come short of it. For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. Okay, didn't profit them anything. For we who have what? Believe, do enter that rest. In other words, it's talking about you and I entering into the rest with Christ Jesus. We believe, we enter into that rest. What does that mean? That means that I rest in confidence in Him, that I say, here, and I surrender my life and say, yes, Lord, I rest in You. All right? So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest, although the works which were finished from the foundation of the world. For He has spoken in a certain place of the seventh day, listen carefully, of the seventh day in this wise, and God rested on the seventh day from all His what? Works. Okay. And again in this place, they shall not enter my rest, since therefore remains that some must what? Enter it. And those to whom it was first preached did not enter because of disobedience. They didn't enter into God's rest. They were legalistic, but they didn't enter in because of disobedience. Again, He designated a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time as it has been said, today, if you'll hear His voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them what? Rest. Then He would not afterwards have spoken another day. Joshua could not give them rest. He took them into the land of Canaan. That's not the kind of rest. There remains therefore what? A rest for the people of God. Now, folks, that's the way it reads in English. If you want to read it how it says it actually in Aramaic, which is the language Jesus spoke, it says, there remains a keeping of the Sabbath to the people of God. That's what that text says in Aramaic. There remains a keeping of the Sabbath to the people of God. For he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works as God did from his. Okay, how do I rest? Let me just quickly tell you how to rest. One, have the right attitude. I'm sorry, I have been in situations in home where women have worked all day Friday, getting the house all cleaned and everything right and everything, and so that it was all done for the Sabbath. And when Friday was over and the Sabbath begun, they were so out of sorts that nobody could live with them. That is not Sabbath keeping. It's not what God means. My attitude needs to be right. It's more important that my attitude is right rather than something is clean. And therefore, make sure as you go into the Sabbath that your attitude is right. If you get up Sabbath morning and you're out of sorts, get back in bed and get out on the other side and get right. But you don't need to be having a bad attitude. That's not good Sabbath keeping. Secondly, confession. Confess your sins. Don't go into the Sabbath carrying a great big load of sins on your back. God doesn't want you to do that. You need to get rid of that. Just confess them and get rid of them. It says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Secondly, rest from sin. What do I mean by that? When you get up, Sabbath morning, dedicate your life to God. Give your life to Him. Give Him that day in a special way. Let it be His day. Let Him have it. Don't go on continuing to disobey God. Rest from sin. Stop sinning. Stop disobeying the Lord. Rest from making a living. 6 days you should work. Do all your work. You don't need to work on the seventh. That is God's day. Stop making a living and rest in the Lord. Understand, folks, why God gave the Sabbath. God gave the Sabbath because you and I need to rest. The only way I can be saved is I must rest in what Jesus Christ did for me. I can't do anything to be saved. All I can do is accept what Jesus did. So the Sabbath is to teach me that every week, that I'm to rest in Christ. I'm to rest in what He has done for me. That is how I'm to keep the Sabbath. So I need to rest from making a living. I need to stop work. Also, I need to rest from the bombardment of life. Get away. Get away from all the noise, all the bombardment. Turn that TV off and leave it off, you know, over the Sabbath. You don't need that going on. I never understood. I wouldn't let somebody in my house use some languages and teach my children things and live in my house. You know, I wouldn't have somebody come to my house and live in my house that would teach my kids things were wrong. But I'll put a TV in there and let them listen to all that junk, and that's okay. No, that's not okay. Don't get away from the bombardment of life. Learn to rest in Christ. As He simply said here, "Moreover also I gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between them and me, that they might know that I am the Lord who sanctifies them." God wants you to grow in grace. God wants you to day by day come closer to Him, to learn of His love, to learn of His goodness, to learn all that He wants to do for you, and simply for you to rest. Rest in what He has done for you. If you will do that, God will bless you. Every day will grow sweeter and sweeter and sweeter as you walk with the Lord. I hope that you will enjoy all the wonderful things that God has for you on the Sabbath. Jesus said in Luke chapter 8, "A sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trampled down, and the birds of the air devoured it. Some fell on rock, and as soon as it sprang up, it withered because it lacked moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. But others fell on good ground, sprang up, and yielded a crop 100-fold. Jesus Christ came to sow the seed of truth into this world. And just as every seed has life in it, the Word of God is also life. Jesus said in John 6:63, "The words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life." But sadly, in this day and age, many professed ministers of the gospel don't accept the Bible as God's inspired word because its plain teachings condemn their practices. They have tried to make it appear mysterious and obscure in order to excuse their own transgressions of God's law. There are those who try to make everything seem pleasant and positive. They gloss over or ignore the warnings of God, and thus they strip the Bible of the power to convict sinners of their need of salvation. But no matter how brilliant and how pleasant they sound, their message cannot satisfy the spiritual hunger of a true seeker. The truth is that ever since the fall of man, Satan has been busy sowing the seed of error. But friends, when the Word of God is preached in simplicity and sincerity, it's powerful. instead of pointing out the errors of others or seeking to combat the opponents of the gospel, we must follow the example of Christ and simply sow the seeds of truth. Oh yes, there will be seeds that will fall by the wayside, be eaten by the birds. Other seeds will sprout in stony soils, only to dry up for the light of the Lord. Still others will fall among the thorns, but many will spring up and bear abundant fruit. The sower's job is to sow seed, and believe me, there is no greater joy than to see the lives transformed under the influence of the Holy Spirit. It's an experience all of us need, and it's the only goal we have as a ministry. We have a marvelous opportunity to sow by farming out life to the whole world. Jesus gave all of us the gospel mission.
Please consider what you can do for those who still don't know about Jesus. As the Holy Spirit impresses, you may send your tax-deductible gifts to Kenneth Cox Ministries, Post Office Box 1-7-4-9-2-3-5-4, or call us toll-free at 888-747-9-2-3-5-4. Thank you for helping us to bring the voice of hope to millions all around the world.
Been listening to LPJ Spreaker Radio with Mr. and Mrs. Sweetthang.
Well, I had a great day. It was real, real great sermon. The sermon was so good, it's just hard
to explain
how great they were. I learned a lot from them. I hope that you did.
I know that we did, and we just want to thank the Lord and even how He shows us how to keep the Sabbath and what the Sabbath is all about. And it is important that we keep the Sabbath, because He had hallowed that day in the beginning before we was even thought of.
And some of the men that gave the sermon were
Kenneth Cox and Joe Cruz.
Men that have been around for many, many years preaching the Word of God, that have been called by God and have served Him for many years, that know the Word of God.
And they stand firmly fixed on His Word.
And I love those men. We're going to take a small break here. We'll be back at 3:30 with more of the Sword for your body, mind,
and soul.
And we hope you enjoyed what you heard. So take a small break. Fix yourself for more of the Word of God here on Speaker Radio LPJ.
And may God continue to bless you in hearing of His Word, and not just a hearer, but a doer of His Word as well.